Evening, everybody. Good evening. It is Wednesday evening, and tonight we are chatting to Dr. Suleiman Halen. He is a fertility specialist at Cape Fertility Clinic in Cape Town, South Africa. So if you have just joined us, we are talking to Dr. Suleiman Halen, and we are discussing what causes ovulation problems. I see Dr. Halen is on. Dr. Halen, we're just going to give everyone just a few minutes to get the notification, to come online, and they can join us. And thank you, Joy, for joining us. Lubuntu, thank you very much for joining us. We are chatting, and then it's Weedy Isaacs and Gertrude. Thank you for joining us this evening. Liesl Spannenberg, yay, your doctor's on. We're chatting to your doctor tonight, Liesl. And I've got Izan. Okay, so we've got a few guys on. Thanks for joining us, guys. So we're just going to invite Dr. Halen now. There we go. Okay, he's joining us. There we go. Good evening, Dr. Suleiman Halen. How are you?
I'm very well, and how are you?
I'm good, thank you. Thanks everyone for joining us, and thank you, Dr. Halen, for joining us. It's always a pleasure having you chat to the ladies, you know, with regards to infertility and the problems. And I think everybody really, really appreciates you taking the time out to join us and talking to us. We've already got questions, guys. We will just wait till after Dr. Halen actually does the talk, and then we're going to get him to answer your questions. So this evening we are talking about what causes ovulation problems. Dr. Halen, maybe you can just start off by introducing yourself, telling the ladies who you are for those who don't know you. And take it from there.
Well, thanks, Suleiman. I'm Dr. Suleiman Halen. I'm working at Cape Fertility Clinic. Originally from Belgium, but I'm now a South African living here for the last 25 years. I'm also the president of SASREG, which is a South African Society of Reproductive Medicine and Gynecological Endoscopy. So that's basically me. So tonight I have to speak about ovulation problems. And ovulation problems are quite common. They are a common cause of infertility. So if you look at the general causes of infertility, then you look like there can be male problems and there can be female problems. Now, if you look at the female problems, there are four big causes. And I'm sure all of you know about it. We can say endometriosis. We know about blocked fallopian tubes, then fibroids of the uterus, and last but not least, the ovulation problems. And tonight we're going to speak about ovulation problems. Now, all of you, I just want you to think for 1 second. How do you know if you've got an ovulation problem? Okay? Because I've got lots of people, lots of women coming to me saying, I've got an ovulation problem. How do you know? Mm-hmm. Just 1 second silence, okay? That is very easy. The diagnosis of an ovulation problem is extremely easy. If you have a regular menstrual cycle, if you menstruate more or less every month, then you do ovulate. It's virtually guaranteed. So I've got always these women coming in my office, and they are referred by other doctors with blood. They say, I don't ovulate. And then I ask, how is your menstrual cycle? I say, no, my menstrual cycle has always been regular. Then it is nearly guaranteed that you ovulate. And then I always check it. I check with the scan, I check with blood tests, and in case like that, where there is a normal and regular cycle, there is ovulation. So how do you know that you don't ovulate? Well, it's also very easy. Then your period becomes irregular. So the period can become very short, or the duration of the period can become long. So instead of bleeding 5 to 7 days, you bleed for 10 days or 2 weeks or 3 weeks, or you keep on bleeding all the time. Or you have no periods, or the periods are becoming extremely irregular. For instance, you've got only 3 or 4 periods every year, or you have your period every second month or every third month. These are all typical symptoms for ovulation problems. So the best way to know if you have got an ovulation problem is to look at the menstrual cycle. A normal and regular menstrual cycle is very reassuring. So then we look at what can be the cause of an ovulation problem. And I would like to address quickly another misconception. A lot of women also, they come in my office and they're diagnosed with an hormonal imbalance. Okay, they say, okay, my hormones are not right. That is not a diagnosis. Okay, that's the same as you say, I'm coughing. That's also not a diagnosis. And hormonal imbalance is just a description of a problem. So the question is, which hormone is imbalanced? What is the correct diagnosis? And therefore, the different hormone levels must be measured and it must be adequately diagnosed before a treatment is done. So an hormonal imbalance, let me repeat that, it's not a diagnosis. It's just a description and it needs a further work up to see what exactly is going on. There are multiple causes of ovulation problems. And I'm going to speak quickly about the most common ones. I'm not going to speak about everything because that's impossible in this short time, but I'm going to speak about the most common ones. And if you look at an ovulation problem, about 80% of the ovulation problems are caused by one big culprit. And there's a very well-known one. It's called polycystic ovarian syndrome. So PCOS, or polycystic ovarian syndrome, is the most common cause of ovulation problems. Then there are other causes of ovulation problems, like an early menopause, like problems with the thyroid, like a dysfunction of the pituitary gland, like a prolactin, problems with the prolactin, or some medication that is used. So let's go step by step and start maybe with the big one, with polycystic ovarian syndrome. So let me repeat, polycystic ovarian syndrome is by far the most common ovulation syndrome. So women with this problem, they present with irregular periods and very often also weight gain and abnormal skin and skin problems. The two most common ones are hair growth that you're not happy with, abnormal hair growth, and acne. And polycystic ovarian syndrome is also associated with health problems. That is very important to understand. It's just not an ovulation problem or a gynecological problem. It's associated with two major health problems, and they are diabetes and high blood pressure. So women with polycystic ovarian syndrome are at increased risk of having these two diseases. But the nice thing about polycystic ovarian syndrome is that it is very easy to treat. So it's for us as fertility doctors is a very satisfying treatment, because very often we do not have to give aggressive treatment. Polycystic ovarian syndrome is very treatable. How can we treat it? Mm-hmm. Well, we try to restore the ovulation. And I'm speaking purely from a fertility point of view, because there are also other approaches that sometimes are used for women who are not trying to conceive. But if you look from a fertility point of view, we're trying to restore ovulation. Before we always start, we always speak about weight loss, because we know that weight loss with polycystic ovarian syndrome is beneficial. And then again, I would like to stress that it is important just to understand that a little bit of weight loss is good. So if you are overweight and you say, okay, my ideal weight is 60 kilograms, I need to lose 30 or 40 kilos, it's never going to happen, that's okay. Don't worry about it. Yeah. Even if you lose 1 or 2 or 3 kilograms, every kilogram helps. So that's one of the starting points for polycystic ovarian syndrome. But then we are not stopping there, and we're going to say, okay, you want a baby, we're going to help you, we're going to give you medication to make you ovulate. And the start is with tablets. We give you tablets, and these tablets, they are the old good one that most of you know, it's Clomid, but there is a newer drug which is called Letrozole. And Letrozole, or Femara, is now the preferred treatment for polycystic ovarian syndrome. That means most women with polycystic ovarian syndrome, they ovulate with Letrozole. And then there are other tablets also. We sometimes give medication which is also used for diabetes and insulin resistance, that's sometimes added to that. And then if the tablets don't work, then we give injections. We give injections with follicle stimulating hormone, and follicle stimulating hormone that works.
Sorry. See, our connection is quite bad this
And
evening.
we
Sorry, Dr. Hayman. Okay.
Is it, yeah? Okay. And then surgery of the ovaries is sometimes done also for polycystic ovarian syndrome, but that's rare. That's called an ovarian drilling, and I would like to stress that that is not the first line treatment for polycystic ovarian syndrome. It's a quite a rare thing to do. So polycystic ovarian syndrome, most women will conceive quickly, even without fertility drugs. Or with just tablets, and if that doesn't work, we can use our ovarian syndrome will need big treatment like IVF or like surgery of the ovary. It's quite uncommon. So if you look at a normal menstrual cycle, then we see that in the beginning of the cycle we develop what we call a follicle. That's And I always say it's an egg factory. It's a little cystic structure in the ovary, but it's not a cyst. But it becomes 2 centimeters, and the egg is growing on the inside of the follicle. So we're growing egg factories. And at the moment of the ovulation, then the egg comes out of the follicle, and then there is an ovulation. And then after ovulation, the follicle stays and it makes what we call progesterone. So in the beginning of the cycle, before ovulation, there is more estrogen, and after ovulation there is more progesterone. And if we have an ovulation problem, then we give the medications, very often follicle stimulating hormone or the tablets that stimulate the pituitary gland, so that the pituitary gland releases follicle stimulating hormone. And then we develop a follicle, we develop an egg factory in the ovary, which is very easily visible on the ultrasound. So that's the corner stone of our fertility treatment, the tablets and injections, which we both use for polycystic ovarian syndrome. So, polycystic ovarian syndrome, the most common cause of ovulation problems. Let me speak quickly about other causes of ovulation problems before we start answering the questions, huh? So there is something about something that we call,
Actually,
yes, I would love to ask the questions. Yes. Go ahead.
okay, but I actually just what I want to do is I actually just want to switch you on to my mobile data rather, because it seems like just in case I lose you while doing that, you can just invite me again, but I will still be here. So give me 1 second because I think we're just losing. There you go. I switched you onto mobile. Should be fine now. Are you there? There we
I'm
go.
here. Yeah.
Okay, perfect. Yeah, let's rather do that. Perfect, because we're getting such a lot of people coming on and listening, and it's a very good subject. So let me rather try and get this as perfect as possible. Here we go. You can carry on,
Yeah.
doctor. Thanks.
So if you want me to answer questions, please interrupt me. Not a problem at all, huh? So
No
there is
worries.
another common cause of another cause, which is maybe not as common as the polycystic ovarian syndrome, which is that there is something wrong with the pituitary gland. So sometimes we call it hypogonadotrophic hypogonadism. So that's a big name, huh? That basically means that the pituitary gland or the structure above the pituitary gland, which is the hypothalamus, does not function properly. So the pituitary gland is the organ, which is an attachment from the brain, that makes FSH, follicle stimulating hormone, the hormone that we need to make an egg, the hormone that stimulates the egg factories, the follicles. So that's not functioning properly. So FSH stays low, the pituitary gland doesn't make that, and therefore the follicle cannot develop. So these women, they also present with no periods or very irregular periods, and they've got associated health problems because it's not the same as for polycystic ovarian syndrome, diabetes and hypertension. but because there is no FSH, there is no follicle, and the follicle makes the estrogen, the female hormone, so there is no estrogen. So the low amount of estrogen can also cause health problems. And the most common one, the most important one, is osteoporosis. So women with a dysfunction of the pituitary gland, they have fertility problems, but they have also got associated health problems. And yes, if women with that problem, if they don't want to conceive, we sometimes just give hormonal treatment. We just give estrogen and progesterone to mimic a natural cycle so that they have enough female hormone to not develop osteoporosis and sometimes also other medical problems. So what is the cause of that pituitary gland problem? Well, I would say there are two major causes of that. It can be a genetic, okay, and I'm not going to go too much in detail about that. There can be different genetic causes for that. And sometimes it's in the unknown. Cause of it. But there are certain genetic diseases that we know very well that we can test for, that we can say, okay, this is a genetic condition that causes that pituitary gland problem. Or it can be because of a low amount of body fat. Okay? So, a low amount of body fat, that means women whose body mass index is too low, typically under 18. So, how can that happen? And again, there are two causes for that low body fat or low BMI or low body fat index, because body fat index is actually a little bit better than BMI. That can be an eating disorder, typically in teenagers, eating disorders, anorexia, bulimia, okay, or athletes, women that are marathon runners, that run a lot, and so therefore, or women that are cyclists or long-distance athletes, Iron Man, I was going to say, but as an Iron Woman, huh? So that are doing long-distance training. And they can have the same problem because of the low amount of body fat. This condition can be reversible. And typically in older women, so in women, older women, in women, in adult women. So if you say you're 25 and you're starting to train very hard and you become a very good marathon runner and your body fat index becomes too low that you don't start having your periods, if that is reversed, and it usually comes back. However, in teenagers, in a young age group, so if teenagers have, for instance, eating disorders, and they have eating disorders when they are 15, 16, and for a few years, no periods, and then in the majority of the cases, they recover. Huh? So once they're 18, 19, 20, they recover, and then, but the period can stay away. This problem can become irreversible in up to 50% of the cases. So a lot of these young women, even they're fully recovered from their eating disorder or from their low body fat, they, when they're a little bit older and they've got a normal BMI, they still have no periods because the pituitary gland is still not functioning properly. So for them, it's important to make sure, if they do not want to conceive, to make sure that they've got enough estrogen, that they don't have the associated health issues, mainly the osteoporosis. And if they want to conceive, we can help them. And how can we help them? Well, we know already, because the pituitary gland is not making enough FSH. So what do? We give FSH, okay? And that is very effective. And in the majority of the case, we must add another hormone that comes from the pituitary gland, which is called LH. So we give a combination of FSH and LH to stimulate the growth of the follicle, and that we can check with the ultrasound. And we have to be a little bit careful, because if we stimulate too little, it's not working. If we stimulate too much, then we can make too many eggs. So it's a bit of a tricky situation. But we as fertility doctors, that's what we do. Huh? So we give these injections with follicle stimulating hormone, And we check it with the scan. We track that follicle, that round thingy that we see on the scan, that egg factory. And then we can make a woman with that problem, with that pituitary gland problem, ovulate. So it's also a very treatable condition. And the majority of the women we can help without doing IVF, without using the big treatment. That's in the majority of general rule for all ovulation problems. Many ovulation problems, we do not need IVF. So if you've got bad endometriosis or blocked fallopian tubes, or if there is a bad sperm count, very often we end up doing IVF. But for ovulation problems, very often other treatment options are possible. That means we can fix it, okay? Or we can make a woman ovulate, and therefore it's not necessary to do IVF. So I would say it's a good diagnosis to have an ovulation problem. It's better than to have blocked fallopian tubes, for instance, because it's more difficult to treat. And then we've got another common problem of the ovulation problem, that's the lack of eggs. Of sometimes it's called premature ovarian failure or early menopause. There are different names for that. But and that's my story of my egg basket, which I tell to everybody. A man makes millions of sperm cells every day. A woman is born with a certain amount of eggs. So I always say you must imagine it. When you're having your periods, you're given an amount of eggs, okay? A basket full of eggs, and that's it, okay? And the egg basket becomes smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller. If you're pregnant or not, it doesn't matter. If you take birth control or not, it doesn't matter. It's just biology. It happens. And then at the age of menopause, that means around 50, 51, that egg basket is empty. And then there are no periods anymore, because there is no female hormone anymore. And then that is what we call menopause. Now, some women, they are not lucky. They're born with a small amount of eggs. So they are not given that same amount of eggs. It can be just because of bad luck, or it can also be because of a genetic condition. So there are certain genetic conditions that we know that can lead to a low ovarian reserve, and we can test for that. But some women are just born with a low amount of eggs, and it can also run in families. So you say, okay, that the mother had menopause at the age of 40, and the daughter will also have the menopause at the age of 40 instead of the age of 50. So it can also sometimes run in families.
Yeah.
And so there are other causes also for that early menopause, or for that premature ovarian failure, or let's call it better, a low ovarian reserve. It can be cancer treatment, okay? For instance, breast cancer treatment, when we have to give chemotherapy, or it can be surgery of the ovaries. So we always have to be very careful if we do surgery of the ovaries, because if you go to the ovaries and we cut in the ovaries, we can cut away eggs, which we don't want to do. So any ovarian surgery for typically endometriosis, but also for other ovarian cysts, must be done very careful, because we do not want to cut away eggs. That's very important. So
and what about ovarian drilling? Sorry to break your word, but ovarian, that is always
ovarian drilling. Yeah, it's a very good question, because ovarian drilling, huh, I don't like it too much, and there are only very few indications for ovarian drilling, and it's only done in women with polycystic ovarian syndrome that do not respond on fertility drugs, only for them. Because if you do a too aggressive ovarian drilling, you can also destroy eggs and destroy the ovarian reserve. So it must be done for the appropriate indication, and it must also be done carefully, okay, that you do not destroy too much of the ovaries. So it's a very good point, Leanne. Yeah, any surgery of the ovaries must be done quite conservatively. For women who still like to have a baby, do not to destroy eggs, do not to remove all these eggs. Yeah. But then Then, if you look at the low ovarian reserve, or if the egg basket is empty, huh? If it's empty, it's empty. And sometimes women come to me and say, "Doctor, what can you do about that? We can't do anything about it." Huh? So if the egg basket is very small, sometimes there is still an egg that comes out, and women are sometimes lucky that they can still conceive. But if it's empty, it's empty. And even the best fertility drugs will not help for that. So there's nothing we can do about it. So that's actually a very bad diagnosis to have, because the treatment options are very limited. And unfortunately, in the majority of the cases, these women, the only option for them to be pregnant is to do egg donation, to use a donor egg from another woman to fertilize it and then to implant inside her. And that is a good treatment option, but unfortunately, in a lot of cases, when there is a diminished ovarian reserve or an early menopause, it's not so easy to treat from a fertility point of view. And also, these women, like again, they've got associated health problems. And for all ovulation problems, it's important always not just to focus on the fertility, but also on the associated health problems. These women can have hot flushes, but they also have got an increase of osteoporosis because of the low amount of estrogen. And yes, we can help with that too. There are easy solutions for this, fortunately. That's your doggy.
So,
Yes.
sorry,
No,
I'm
that's
sorry,
fine.
that's too. Okay, I've got. Are you ready to answer one or two questions, Dr.
Yeah,
Annan?
I still have got other things to talk about, but I
Oh,
mean, I can. I
sorry,
will
I'm
do.
sorry.
No, it's fine. I mean, there are two maybe other courses that I would like to mention quickly, okay, that are not too uncommon, that are thyroid problems, okay, problems with the thyroid and problems with the prolactin, okay. The prolactin is also a hormone that comes from the pituitary gland, and when it's too high, it can sometimes also cause irregular periods, ovulation problems, and infertility. And again, there are two causes of that abnormal prolactin. It can be because of a tumor from the pituitary gland, and we can check that with a CT scan or an MRI scan. Or it can be sometimes caused by certain medications, some antidepressants. And I'm not speaking about the normal antidepressants, but the more advanced antidepressants can also cause problems with the prolactin. So that's also one that we have. And the symptoms of a too high prolactin are infertility and irregular periods, and then very often abnormal nipple discharge. So if that's the case in combination with an abnormal period, then we can think about a too high prolactin. And another one I would like to mention quickly is thyroid problems. It's not uncommon, and thyroid problems are a lot more common in women than in men. The scientists are not sure yet why that's the case, but it's about five times more common thyroid problems in women than in men. And both too much of thyroid hormone and too little of thyroid hormone can cause problems with the ovulation. So too much thyroid hormones, that means hyperthyroidism, can also have other symptoms like unexplained weight loss, feeling heart palpitations, feeling of anxiety, nervousness, and can have an effect on the menstrual cycle. Too little thyroid hormone is mostly the opposite effect. These women, they can gain weight easily, they are fatigued, they can feel cold, they've got heavy periods and also irregular periods. So thyroid problems are not too uncommon, and it is quite easy to treat and quite easy to diagnose because we can do a blood test to check for thyroid hormone and to see if there's too little or too much. Especially if it's too little, we can just give thyroid hormone in a tablet. If it's too much, sometimes it's more difficult to treat and we need the help of an endocrinologist. But it's common and it's easy to fix. Very often we're just taking a tablet every day, and we can help these women. And it has also got, again, associated health problems and also increased risks in pregnancy, especially in the first trimester. So thyroid problems must also be taken serious. So these are the most common ones. So the polycystic ovarian syndrome, the problems with the pituitary gland, the low ovarian reserve in the thyroid and the prolactin. There are other causes of ovulation problems, of course, but these are the classical ones, the ones that we see mostly at the fertility clinic.
Okay.
So that was half an hour. So shall we ask, shall we answer some questions now, Leanne?
Yeah, let's answer just one or two questions. We don't want to keep everyone too long. One important says, if regular VitaCol SA said, if regular cycles but very slightly, example 26 days, 29 days, therefore LH surge by ovulation kit differs. Is ovulation guaranteed? Example day 20, what delays conception?
Yeah,
I don't know if you heard it correctly.
so I mean, I'm not sure if I understand the question properly, but if you ovulate later, so if you ovulate on day 20, okay, then your period will be 2 weeks after ovulation. So sometimes women say they have got a 26-day cycle. That means they didn't ovulate on day 14, but maybe on day 12. And then the next month, the cycle is 30 days. That means they didn't ovulate on day 14, but on day 16, okay? Or if you ovulate on day 20, then your period will come on day 34. Okay, so then the cycle will become longer. Now, it's, I mean, obviously simplification, eh? Because we sometimes have also got a problem of the luteal phase. It's fortunately not that common, huh? But the luteal phase means from the moment of the ovulation until the period, which is usually exactly 2 weeks. But if there is a problem in the progesterone production, okay, if the corpus luteum doesn't function properly, it's not too common, then the luteal phase can become shorter. So a woman can, for instance, have a cycle of 28 days and ovulate on the but it's not a very common problem. So the golden rule is if your period becomes shorter, your ovulation becomes earlier. If your period becomes longer, your ovulation will be later. That's the golden rule, and it's true in the majority of the cases.
Okay.
Yes. Other questions?
I think, yeah, there's quite a lot of questions, and I'm trying to get to it all. But I actually think what I'm going to do, Dr. Helen, I was actually going to put it in an email for you. And then what I'm going to do, I'm going to post it, get the responses from Dr. Helen, and actually post it on our story feed. And you guys can all see all the responses from Dr. Helen. There is so many questions. That I think the best way to do it is okay, let me just do one more question. I had a miscarriage in
Let me do both.
2019 and I tried with no luck. What can the problem be? So,
We don't know, huh? So this is just
yeah.
if you had a miscarriage and you're not pregnant 2 years later, it must be investigated. It's very likely nothing to do with the miscarriage. It could be, huh? Because the miscarriage sometimes can cause scar tissue of the uterus. But very likely there's another problem, like an ovulation problem, like endometriosis, like a blocked tube, like a low sperm count. I mean, it's very likely that there's something going on that's not been diagnosed yet. So this woman should go for tests together with her husband to see what the cause is. And it's not because she has been pregnant before that there wasn't a problem, eh? Because in the majority of the cases, infertility is not absolute, huh? So, and I think that's very important to understand that most of the causes of infertility just decrease the chance of having a baby. It doesn't make it nil. Like, for instance, women with endometriosis, very often they conceive without treatment. Women with polycystic ovarian syndrome, very often they conceive spontaneous, but the chance is significantly reduced. So maybe there was an issue with this woman, which was not diagnosed. So is it after 2 years, is there still no baby? She needs to go for checks, all the normal standard fertility checks, and then hopefully we'll find the problem. Probably we'll find it.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Helen, for joining us, and thank you for taking your time out to do this talk with us. I'm going to you can contact Dr. Helen at Cape Fertility Clinic. You can also email me directly and I'll send your emails to Dr. Helen, or you can email, I think it's
No,
Suleiman.Helen at Cape Fertility. Am I correct? Sorry.
Shailen, at Cape Fertility. Shailen, yes.
Okay. Sorry, S. Halen at capefertility.co.za,
That's
and
correct.
Dr. Halen is, yeah, he's very quick at responding. We can go visit their website or actually contact them on Instagram as well. So Thank you very much. We have recorded this episode, so if you guys please follow us on YouTube, you can watch all of this over again on YouTube or on Facebook or on Instagram. Thank you very much, Dr. Helen, for this evening.
You're very welcome, Leanne. It was very nice being with you. Take care.
Thank you. Bye.